Thank you very much, Gary, for an absolutely lovely introduction. Not that I compare myself in any way, but I once read that after a particularly moving introduction, Winston Churchill said he could hardly wait to hear what he had to say. I was thinking maybe the introduction should come later, even though it's not that great. Thank you all for being here. It's a delight to be in your beautiful community, and I cannot believe the gorgeous weather. I thought maybe nobody would come tonight because it's the first warm evening. I actually see bear suits and shorts and stuff. This is absolutely lovely. And I know you've had a tremendous amount of rain in this area, so it might seem strange to talk about the talk on the global water crisis. And I'm going to tell you the world's running out of water. You're going to say that I have water on the brain. All you see around here is water. I was in the University of New Hampshire last night, and I stayed with friends whose basement has never flooded in 16 or 20 years or whatever, how long they've been there, and they flooded twice in 2 weeks, and we could see it just pouring in through the cement. I don't know how it was getting through the basement. So, but of course, as we know with climate change, it is climate change, and it means that you'll have more rain some places and less rain other places. All of course, it's New England's going to become a rainforest, so I hope this isn't true. But it feels like it right now, and I have to tell you, I'm Canadian, and we just had the shortest, driest, warmest winter ever recorded right across our country. So the weather patterns, there's no question. Of course, Canadians keep saying, I know it's bad, I know it's bad. We're just saying, oh, but isn't it nice, you know, when the winter gets shorter. So I'm going to talk to you about the global situation, and then I'm going to talk to you about some of the conflicts that are arising. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the U.S., and I'm going to talk a little bit about what we can do, because although I'm going to get you upset first, I'll then tell you that there's lots of hope there is. And then I just want to have a conversation with you. We can just have a discussion about, you know, futures and what people can do and what you think about the situation that I've said and so on. It's the first thing to say, to establish, is that we all learned something I call the myth of abundance back in around, I don't know, grade six. We all learned this one lesson, that there's a finite, exact amount of water in the hydrologic cycle. It's always been here, around, and you can't go anywhere. And so you can use as much as you want. You cannot destroy it. That's what we all learned. It's not true. Our teachers were not lying, but it is not true. In fact, what we are doing is that we are taking this very finite amount of water and we're polluting it, diverting it, displacing it from where we can get at it, dumping it in the ocean, pouring it in deserts. We are rapidly actually becoming the planet running out of available fresh water. The water is still here somewhere on the planet, but we are taking it from where we can access it to where we can no longer access it or it's not clean enough to use. And if you were to put all the world's water in a 1 gallon container, the amount of available fresh water would be just about a teaspoon. So it's a really tiny, tiny amount of the full amount of water on the planet that we have. And we are going to be adding another 3 billion people to the planet before the population starts to level off. So the demand is going to continue. In fact, the World Bank just came out with a new study. It's not a number, it just came out and it says that, they said that in the next 20 years, the demand for water in the world is going to outstrip supply by 40%, which is just a stunning statistic when you really stop and think about the human lives that we're talking about. So the story is this. First of all, we're polluting surface water around the world at a very, very rapid rate, particularly in the global south, but we're also just polluting here in North America as well. But in some countries like India, 75% of those surface waters are polluted. In China, 85% of the surface water is polluted, but you can also pollute groundwater. China has polluted 90% of the groundwater under its major municipalities, under its big cities. To mining groundwater. And we developed a technology really in the last 50 years that didn't exist before. There were wells, but there were no deep bore wells. And in some cases we're talking about bore wells that go into the ground that are as deep into the ground as skyscrapers go into the sky. You've got to try to imagine the depth of what we're talking about here. And we're putting these bore wells into the groundwater all over the world. And we're pumping up that groundwater far, far, far faster than it can be replenished by nature. And we're also draining our rivers, pumping our rivers to death as well. Most of the major crops that shouldn't be grown there. And there was a famous lake called the Aral Sea in the former Soviet Union that was so big they called it a sea. And they used it to produce water for cotton in the desert. And of course, with time, you just create more and more desert. The water dries up. The desert stops producing cotton, and it's pretty well gone. We also send huge amounts of land-based water. I'm talking about water that's falling into the ocean, but land-based water into the mega cities around the world. And you need to remember now, more of us live in the cities than not. A couple of years ago, that shift came. And so, and a lot of us live in major, major urban centers, 20, 30, 40 million people. And so there's an enormous thirst in these cities. And the more sophisticated we get, so-called, the more urbanized, the wealthier we get, the more stuff we have, the more water we use, called virtual water. That's all the water embedded in all the stuff that we have. And so that demand is very, very big, particularly in wealthy cities. And we suck that water up. And then when we're finished with it, we consider it waste and we dump it in the ocean. And I'm working with scientist colleagues, who estimate that we're probably dumping about 200 trillion gallons of land-based water into the oceans every year. This is not water that falls into the ocean. This is water that we're transferring. So we really need to start thinking about this as being one of the causes of climate change, that we are actually creating desert and displacing water from ecosystems that need it. And it has not been part of the negotiation or the discussions at the COP process in Copenhagen and others around climate change. But the way we are displacing water is actually a cause of climate change. Then there's a terrible way we grow crops. We use intensive agricultural production. We use chemicals. Chemicals, particularly the Green Revolution, required 3 to 5 times as much water to wash away the chemicals. So we pump that water up so that we can feed more people per acre of land. Biofuel production is insane. It takes 1,700 gallons of water to produce 1 gallon of ethanol. And we are now using about a third of the world's global water withdrawals just are now being converted into new sources of fuel. Fuel to feed cars, basically, because we don't want to give up our car addiction. Then we have something called virtual water trade. Now, this is the water that's embedded in a commodity or something else that you produce, and then you export right out of the area, right? You export it not just out of your watershed, but you export it right out of the country itself. And so, again, it's just like sticking a pipe in a watershed and just sucking the water up. We may as well be doing that as doing this. The mining industry sucks up another 250 trillion gallons of water every year. And then we have urbanization, deforestation, and destruction of wetlands. When you remove the green stuff, the forest and the vegetation, the hydrologic cycle doesn't work. It needs green stuff for the process of transpiration and evaporation. If it doesn't get that, the rains move away, the vapors move away. We know when we cut down a rainforest, it stops raining. We know when we create more and more urbanization, we create heat islands. The big urban centers are called heat islands. And when it rains, it's like falling on a great big cement umbrella and it just rolls. It doesn't go down into the ground, it doesn't seep back to replenish the rainwater and the groundwater. So what, as a consequence, the Earth is literally beginning to dry up. We're seeing what some scientists call sandscapes. Desert is expanding in 100 countries in our world. I call it the perfect drought. Atmospheric dust has tripled in a century, and half the planet's land surface is now classified as dry land. Now, this is very important because you've got to imagine the growth of the population and the demand with the growth of these deserts. So scientists are beginning to talk about something called hot stains, and these are parts of the world that are running out of water. You will read that they're experiencing drought. Drought's a nicer phrase than the end of water, right? So people will talk about drought because at the end of drought, my goodness, will come rain. Well, not if there's no water. Not if we've removed all the water from the system and the hydrologic cycle isn't functioning properly.